Tonight's message comes from the series entitled, Us or Them, Which One Are You? From my beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb. Tonight's subtitle will be, Faith and Patience.
Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. And if you would be so kind to lift up your voice like a trumpet and declare verses 1 and 2 with me this morning from chapter 4 of the book of Hebrews. And it reads, Let us therefore fear, lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. And all God's people said amen,
amen.
And amen.
Amen.
We're talking about us or them, which one are you? And today we're talking about faith and patience. Give three people a high five and tell them, go ahead, it's all about him. It's all about him. Jesus Christ, the center, the circumference, the base, the boundary, the balance, the beauty, the sum and the substance, and that's why we are here. If it wasn't for the Lord Jesus Christ, we wouldn't be here. Because the Bible tells and teaches us that Jesus Christ created everything and he made us. Hallelujah. And so we're thankful and grateful that we're not here by accident, incident, nor coincidence. But it was the providence of God. And that's the reason why we should not hate ourselves, because it was God. He is the one that brought us here. And as we love God, ourselves, and everybody else, see, the way the world is, the world just love those that love them and salute those that salute them and hello to those that hello to them. But a Christian, true Christian, we love like God loves. And the Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's the way we are. We have the nature of God. When we receive Jesus Christ, we receive God's nature in us. Jesus lives on the inside of us. And that's why the Bible says greater is he that is on the inside of us than he that is in this world. Greater is he. And so we have no reason nor right to be depressed or suppressed, because every morning we should think about living above the common fray of everyday negativity of this world's hypocrisy and the gravity and poverty that pulls you down. Why? Because in 1 Peter, he says that we are a chosen generation. You didn't choose God. God chose you. We are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, and we should show forth the praises of him that saved us. We should show forth the praises of him. Lift up our hands, wave our hands, shout hallelujah. Because when you shout, you cast out doubt. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. And then God has ordained that we live the life that he has ordained for us to live. And that's a life of faith. Romans chapter 1:17. So then the just shall live by faith. And when we live by faith, we live a life beyond fear. And that is to say, a life beyond fear is fop, foaf, and four. Can you say that? Fop, foaf, and four. The fear of people. Fop, the fear of failure. Foaf, and the fear of rejection. Four. We should never feel rejected, because God has accepted each and every one of us. If we receive the gift that he's given unto us, and that is his son. Now, this morning, I'm continuing the series, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, and we want to focus in on that again. And it says in verse 1, let us, say us. Therefore, fear, that word fear is reverential fear. It's not the fear of the devil. It's a respect for our God. Let us therefore fear, lest the promise being left us, say us. of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. You can come short of the promise of God, because he tells us in verse 2, for unto us, say us.
Us.
Now here's the point right here. Here's the revelation of the difference. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, meaning it profit us, but it did not profit them. It profit us, say it profit us, but it did not what? Profit them. Why? Not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. See, some do, some won't, some will, some won't. And so what God is telling us is that we are to be in us, not of them. Because in the same congregation, you have the same message, same time, same place, coming from the same preacher. But some do and some don't. Some will and some won't receive it. Why? Because it takes faith and patience, and you will see that. It takes faith and patience. Chop, we have faith in this house. Can you say that? We have faith in this house with authority. We have faith in this house. But in order to keep it, we must rehearse what we've heard in order to keep the faith that we have. We must rehearse what we heard. See, some people just come to church and they just hear the preacher preach, but they don't rehearse what they heard. It's like going to school. In order for you to keep what the teacher is teaching, you must rehearse what you heard the teacher teach. Listen to what it says in chapter 1. Look at chapter 1. Are you there? Chapter 2, rather. Not chapter 1, chapter 2. He says, listen to this. In verse 1 of chapter 2, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard. We ought to give the more earnest heed. Say, pay attention.
Pay attention.
We ought to pay attention to what the preacher is saying, because the preacher is your prosperity connection. God has called, chosen, equipped, qualified, sanctified, appointed, anointed, elected, selected, ordained the preacher to preach to you so that you will be connected to what God has for you. That's a greater blessing. How are you doing? There you go. How are you doing? I'm doing better. I'm doing better. I say that at least 10 times in the morning. I say it at least 20 times in the afternoon. And I say it about 30 times in the evening. I'm doing better. I'm doing better. I'm doing better. And no matter where the pain is coming from, no matter where it's happening, no matter what's going on, my confession is the same. I'm doing better. I'm doing better. I'm doing better. See, that's us. But how about the them? The them will tell you, I'm not doing so good. And the reason why you're not doing good is because you're not confessing what God will have you to confess. And if you don't confess it, you can't possess it. Hello? So God is wanting you to say what God has promised you that he will give you. If you say it and obey it, it will certainly and surely come to pass. How are you doing? I'm doing better. I'm doing better. Now listen to what he says. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard. Now hear this now. Lest at any time we should let them slip. See, it's easy to let what you heard slip. And when you let it slip, then you don't have what you heard. This is why we should rehearse what we heard in order for us to keep the faith that we have. Because fear is everywhere. My friend, listen to me. Fear is everywhere. Wherever you go, fear. Wherever you go, there's fear. This world is filled with fear. And in order for you to have encouragement, you need to hear faith. And how does God send faith? Frank, he sends it because he sends the mailman. And who is the mailman? The mailman is the preacher. And he says this in Romans chapter 10, verse 13 on through 17. He says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And he tells us how faith comes. He says, because I'm sending you the preacher to preach to you, right? So therefore, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Without faith, you are in fear. You're in doubt, fear, and unbelief. See, this world is a world of unbelief. It is a world of unbelief. And before you have faith, what you have is unbelief. You have doubt. This is a doubtful generation. It's a doubtful world. You doubt this, doubt that, doubt. And when you move from doubt, you move from doubt to, listen, fear. You move into fear because fear is everywhere, meaning you have every right and reason to be fearful because you live in this sin-sick secular world. And in this world, I mean, listen, when you watch the news and listen to the news, it's nothing but fear, nothing but fear. You turn to the news station and everything is fear, 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 fear. I remember, you know, it used to be when I was a little boy coming up, on Saturdays, they would have cartoon shows. On Saturdays, they would have also sitcoms, Father Knows Best, Lucy. They would have all these kind of things that would make you be cheerful. But in the world that we live in today, everything is murder. Everything is killing, everything is hurting, everything is, it's just murder stuff going on. Now my wife, she loves the mystery stuff, but I just can't watch that stuff. Why? Because fear is everywhere. Doubt, fear, and unbelief. This is what this world consists of. Doubt, fear, and unbelief. This is the reason why it used to be, and I would take to some degree, maybe it still is this today, but it used to be when you had to go to court and you had to swear in, they would tell you, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, or nothing but the truth, so help you God. Because if you don't have so help you God, you ain't telling the truth. If you don't have a God that can help you tell the truth, the devil is going to encourage you through doubt, fear, and unbelief. You're not going to be truthful. Hello. So that's why they included, so help you God. And on your money tells you, in God we trust. The money that you have, before you spend your money, read it. It's telling you, in God we trust. Whether it's a dollar, whether it's a $5, whether it's a $10, whatever, the money is telling you it's in God we trust. Because see, if we don't trust God, and the only way we can trust God is by hearing the word of God. If you don't hear the word of God, then what it is, it's unbelief because it's a lack of faith. And then from a lack of faith, it's little faith. And from little faith, it's no faith. So you end up with a lack of faith. But when you come to a church such as this, you're going to hear the word of God. And the word of God brings you the faith. It brings you faith. Now the sad commentary is a lot of people hear the word, but they do not operate in faith. And this is why he says, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. It was preached to both of us. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached didn't profit them. It profited me, but it didn't profit them. Why? Not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. It wasn't that they didn't hear the same thing that us heard, but they did not obey what us obeyed. And this is what he is telling us here. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them. Now I want you to look at this again. In Hebrews chapter 2, this time I want to move to verse 2. Hebrews chapter 2. Look my way just for a moment. The word Hebrew means one from the other side. Can you say that? One from the other side. That's what Hebrew means. What? One from the other side. And the question becomes, what side are you on? What side are you on? Are you on the wrong side or are you on the other side, which is the Lord's side? God had Moses to come out and says, who's on the Lord's side? See, because he's talking to the children of Israel. He's talking to God's people, but all God's people were not on God's side. They were on the side of unbelief. And you got so many Christians, they function in unbelief, doubt, fear, and unbelief. Notice what he says in chapter 2 of Hebrews, one from the other side, verse 2. He says, for if the word spoken by angels was steadfast. Now, when he says angels, he's not talking about angelic beings. The word angels mean messengers. In other words, glory to God, he sent the messenger. So I'm not tooting my horn. Please forgive me if it sounds like that. But he's talking about, Bishop, you an angel. It gives me chill bumps. You are a messenger. You are an angel. I'm sending you with a message. And this is what he says. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? How will we escape? You can't escape it. This is why a Christian end up down, depressed, vexed, troubled. Why? Because they do not receive the word from the angel, the messenger. Now go into your Bibles to the book of Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6. Once you found your place there, shout hallelujah. You know, now this kind of word that I'm preaching, it'll cause folk to run out of the church. There are people that's in the church right now. Get out of here, get out of here, get out of here, get out of here. Why? Because, see, the devil don't want you to hear the word of faith. He wants you to stay in fear. He wants you to stay in doubt. Do you realize the devil comes to church? And we know that he comes to church because Jesus said he comes in sheep's clothing, but inwardly he's a ravening wolf, meaning he's out to tear up something. He's out to tear apart something, but he comes to church. Now that is sick, to come to church and you're not coming to church to hear the word. You're not coming to church for the right reason. You're not coming to church, but you come to church. Why? Because you come with sheep's clothing. But inwardly, Jesus said, you got to have the Holy Spirit to discern something's wrong with this picture. Something's wrong with this person. Something's wrong. See, because the person that comes to church, Al, they would say things against the church. They would say things against, I don't believe in all that pastor's preaching, Dr. O'Donnell. I don't believe in that. No, 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 no. See, and what we have to do, you have to recognize that you have to stop listening to what the they say. See, we're the us, but then you got the they says. And the they say what they want to say, when they want to say, how they want to say it, and they do what they say, not what God says. And when we find out who they are, stop listening to what they say. Stop hanging around with the they says. Because Denise, they say ain't gonna help us get what God says. We're not gonna get what God says because we're hanging around the they says. They say this, they say that, they say this, they say, I don't have enough, I don't have that, and all that stuff they say. It's just a bunch of garbage that they say. But when we hear what he say, and we obey what he say, and we believe what he say, why do we believe what he say? Because we believe who he is. He's the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and of earth. He's the deliverer of all of our enemies. He takes us from rags to riches, or from riches to rags. It's all about he, the Most High God. When we know who he is and we know who saved us, then we listen to what he say and we say what he say, because we are his. And it is he that will get you through whatever you're going through. He'll get you through it. He'll get you through it. But it starts with faith. And then Hebrews chapter 6. Are you there? The sixth chapter of the book of Hebrews. Notice what he says. Let's start with verse Hebrews chapter 6. And we want to start with verse 11. And it says, for we desire that every one of you, listen to this, do show. The word show means act on what you believe. Don't just say you believe it and you don't act on it. Because see, faith is acting on what you believe. Hello. Say that. Faith is acting on what you believe. So it's a show. In other words, you're showing that you really do believe what God says. He says, for we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. Now keep that before you. Hope unto what? The end. Hope unto the end. Then he says in verse 12, that you be not slothful. Be not slothful, slow. Well, I'll do it next week. I'll see about if I can give or if I can do or if I can tomorrow. That's slothful. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1 says, no! Now, yeah, he says, now faith is, or faith is now. If you're going to operate by faith, it's now. You have to do it now. In other words, when the phone is ringing and God is calling you to do it now. You can't put it off. And this is what he's saying here. He says, listen again, verse 12, that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. Who through faith and patience. Some, they say, well, I didn't get the promise because you didn't have the patience. Hello. See, in this word patience right here is macrothumia. That's a pretty deep word, ain't it? Every now and then I sound edumacated. Macrothumia, M-A-K-R-O-T-H-U-M-I-A, macrothumia. What it means is long suffering. Patience, long suffering. It's two words for patience. I want you to see this one. He says, but through faith and patience, they inherit the promise. Notice it was two things in order for us to get the promise, in order for us to get what we're hoping for. See, faith is the substance of things that you hope. Hope is in the future. So between the promise and the performance is the patience. And some people can't wait on the Lord. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, it says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall what? Renew their strength. They shall mount up with the wings like an eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They can walk and never faint. They that wait upon the Lord will renew you. The Lord will put gas back in you. Hallelujah. He'll put the power of God back in you. But it takes faith and patience. Macrothumia, can you say that? Macrothumia. How do you spell it? M-A-K-R-O-T-H-U-M-I-A. Macrothumia, and it means long suffering. It means you're going to suffer long. It means you're going to go through some. Did Jesus go through some suffering? Yes, he did. And are you following Jesus? Yes, I am. So then you're going to go through what? Long suffering. He says, who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Go in your Bibles to the book of James now. It is good to me. I'm not going to hold you long. See, I love this side. Okay, I'm hearing one on this side. The rest of you just shaking your head, looking. No amens, no nothing. I'm feeling it over here. I'm only kidding, I love y'all. Listen, James chapter 1, are you there? In James chapter 1, listen to what it says in verse 1. James, now James, this book of James right here, James is the brother of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He's the brother of Jesus. Their mother was Mary. Their father was Joseph. But Joseph did not plant the seed of Jesus in Mary. God was looking for a womb, and he was looking for the egg. That's what he needed from Mary. And what did Mary say? Because God says, you're going to have the Son of God. And Mary said, how shall this be? And then God says, the angel came and spoke to her, and it says, how shall this be? He says, well, the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you. And the power of the highest is going to overshadow you. Now, does that make sense? The Holy Ghost going to come upon me. The power of the highest. And that's how I'm going to have the Son of God, a child. Yeah. What did Mary say? She didn't say what her aunt said when they said about John the Baptist. And they was questioning, and her husband was questioning also, because they had been praying. Listen, now listen, I'm giving you something strong here. They had been praying from their early years, and they were still praying, asking God for a child. The angel shows up, Gabriel, and shows up and says, be happy because your prayer has been answered. God's going to give you a child. And the father said, how can this be, seeing I'm an old man? Well, why are you still praying? Now get a hold of this, Pam, because see, you got people that they're praying, but they're not believing. They're not operating in faith. Because he says, I'm an old man now. How is this going? But you're still praying. And he says, let me tell you what's going to happen. You're not going to open your mouth. You're not going to be able to speak a word until that child is born. Why? Because you will abort the child by your negative confession. You will abort what God has for you because of your negative confession. And when they had John the Baptist, they were asking, what are we going to name him? And they was going to name him after his father. And all of a sudden, his father took the pen and wrote the name John. And when he did that, immediately his mouth was open and he could speak. He could speak. God gave him the permission to speak because he believed in what God had said. His name, God says, and his name shall be called John. 6 months later, the angel Gabriel came to Mary. And Mary was getting ready to marry Joseph. And Mary said, how shall this be? And seeing I know not a man. I have not had no relationship with Joseph. I don't know a man. How am I going to have a child? He said, the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you. The power of the highest going to overshadow you. And what did Mary say? Mary didn't go on unbelief. She says, be it unto me according to thy word. In other words, I don't know how that's going to happen. But be it unto me. If you said it, I receive it. If you said it, I receive it. If you said it, I receive it. You know, Minister Don this morning said, faith is a miracle working seed. See, faith can change facts, and faith can change that. You may be sick today, but faith can change that. Faith can change facts. It can change that. Whatever it is, that's why faith is faith and sense is sense. If you can make sense out of faith, it's no longer faith. Faith is faith and sense is sense. You can't make sense out of faith. You can't come up with good sense out of faith. It's like what Mary said, be it unto me according to what you said. You said it, let it happen. And what happened? They had Jesus. Now James, the brother of Jesus, says this. Notice, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. Then he says, verse 2, my brethren, now pay close attention. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. Now this is powerful, y'all. He says, count it all joy when you what? Fall into diverse temptations. The word diverse is temptation, test, and trials. See, faith always have to be tested. If you say you got faith, it's going to be tested. It's going to be tested to see whether or not you really do have faith in God. He says, now count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, temptation, test, and trials, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Now this word patience is hupomene. The word I just said was macrothumia, which is what? Long suffering. But this word patience is hupomene. H-U-P-O-M-O-N-E. Hupomene. Hupomene. This is what that word is. And what the word hupomene, when he says, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation, tests, and trials, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. See, patience go to work when your faith is being tried. Because hupomene means it's the force of consistency that causes us to remain constant and always the same. See, patience stay on the track. And when patience is on the track and patience got faith's back. See, because the trial is going to push faith back. But before faith can go back, patience got its back. Patience said, I got you covered. Ain't no going back. We're going forward. Why? It's the force of consistency that we're causing us to be constant and always the same. It's the quality of faith in God that does not surrender under circumstances nor succumb under trial. It will not surrender to circumstance nor succumb under trial. It's the force of consistency that causes us to remain constant and always the same. In other words, it's like a ball player. Like a ball game, whatever it is. A person can be good at playing ball, Harry. They can be really good at playing that, but in order for them to be better, they got to practice. Just because you're good at it, that doesn't mean that you're going to be developed and perfected by it. What causes you to be developed and perfected by it is because you practice it. You practice it. You may can drill the ball and drip the ball and hoop the ball and all that kind of things. But if you don't practice it, you may be good, but you're not better. In order to be better, you have to practice it. Am I right about it? Green, am I right? You have to be practice this, what you say that you're good at. And when we come to church, God is telling us, practice it. In order for you to be developed in faith, you have to practice. And how do we practice it? The same way you practice whatever else you practice. You got to practice saying the word of God. You got to practice saying, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory by, through, and in Christ Jesus. You got to practice what we're saying even today. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith. See, it wasn't mixed in faith. You can hear the word and never, listen, be operating in faith. But when you go to operate in faith, then your faith is going to be tested. Your faith is going to be tested to see whether or not you really have faith in God. Now, this past Wednesday, I was talking about how Jesus told them, get in the boat, we're going to the other side. They got in the boat, the sun is shining. Lockhart, I mean, everything was looking good. As we say, hunkadory, we're going to the other side. We're going to the other side. And did not Jesus know that the storm was coming? Yes, he did. He knew the storm was coming, but they had to go through a test. And when they went through the test, when the storm hit the boat, where was Jesus? He was sleeping in the hinder part. Now, here the boat is rocking. They're up all night worrying about what they're going to do. And all the time, where's Jesus? He's in the hinder part doing what? Sleeping. He chilling, man. And they woke Jesus up. And do you know what they said? They said, Master, don't you care? We're going to die. What did Jesus say? We're going to the other side. But what did they say? We're going to die. See, it was a test of their faith. And he showed a test of the faith. And when they got to the other side, they got to the other side, just like he said, Reba, we're going to the other side. They got to the other side. And Jesus said, where is your faith? Then another occasion, he said, how is it that you have no faith? See, people feel that they have faith in God. Jesus just told his disciples, and Jesus is God in human flesh, and he says, how is it that you don't have no faith in God? Now, this is God himself. This is not the preacher. This is Jesus. And they didn't have faith. See, faith must be tested. Faith must be tried. And the quality of faith in God, it never succumb, as it were, under trial. It's the force of consistency that causes us to remain constant and always the same. See, many people, they quit in the middle of the race. They say, man, this ain't working. This ain't help. This ain't going. This ain't working. I tried it. I talked it. I confessed it. See, what patience is, say, it's the force of consistency. The force of consistency. See, and what patience does, patience go through whatever you're going through without giving God a deadline to get you out. Sandra, isn't that good? See, you got people that say, well, by Friday, if that don't happen by Friday, if God don't do something by Friday, no, and guess what? It ain't gonna happen Friday. Why? Because see, now you're trying to test God. You're trying to tell God what to do. And God is able to get you through whatever you're going through. Hallelujah. But if you put a timeline on God, that's not patience. I tried. No, you haven't tried. Faith is being tried. You haven't tried, but faith is being tried. Your faith is being tried. And now patience is going to work. He said, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation, tests, and trials, knowing this. Oh, I'm going to let you go. But knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Patience go to work. Now hear this now. This is very interesting right here. It says, but let patience have her feminine gender. Patience is the her. Faith is the him. And patience is the her. Hallelujah. And that's why God gave Adam a helpmeet. not just a helpmate, but a helpmeet, in order for Adam to be the man that he became. Eve was the helpmeet. And what God says, that let patience have her feminine gender, perfect work. Her perfect work. Her perfect work. Now, usually, you know, last week we had the, I invited the men. I said, I need the men to come up because we only had, I think it was just two men up. The women were up, man, praising God, singing and magnifying God. This is men's day. This is the man's day. James, we ought to be up here. This is man's day. This is a man's day. But the women, they come up, their hearts is tender, their hearts is loving God. They'll come up. But men, we got this. Some men won't even lift their hands to God. They're just looking around. And this is why it is so, this is why it is so magnified that it says, and David danced before the Lord. Because men, you know, when it comes to dancing, now those brothers, I want to join their group. Them boys was moving all kinds of stuff. Put me in the group, man. Oh, that's right, I'm the pastor. I can't be in the group. All right. But here's the point I want you to know. See, men, we like the slow drag. We like the slow drag for the most part. And then we like being cool. You know what I'm saying, brother? We just cool with it, man. That's the way men are. Men just cool. You know what I'm saying, Frank? And what God is saying is, be bold, be strong, for the Lord thy God is with thee. Be bold, be strong. Don't be ashamed to move and dance. Don't be ashamed to scream and shout. Don't be ashamed to jump and holler. Hallelujah. Be a man, be a man, be a man. He says, let patience have her perfect work that you may be, listen, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that give to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that waver is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he should receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Unstable in all his ways. Now, I'm not picking on us brothers. I'm a brother. But I'm saying that we have to recognize what God is saying unto us, faith and patience. You can say, well, I got faith, but you got to let patience go to work. Because faith will be tested. And so many people quit in the middle of the test. They jump out of the race because they feel it's not working. And all the time it's working, but you have to work it. You have to work with it. It's not abracadabra. You have to work with it. And when you're going through it, it helps you. Now I'm going to close with this. Romans, turn to Romans. Double-minded man, unstable in all of our ways. Romans chapter 5, we close here. Here's the process. I'm just going to read it real quick and hum it on down. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. All these cool daddies. I'm not picking on you, I'm just saying. I'm just saying, be bold. When you come to church, step in the boldness. And why so many people are not healed is because they won't do what God say. Am I right, George? They won't do what God say. God is saying, dance. I can't dance because I can't. See, unless you begin to at least step out by faith. And the word dance, you heard me say, mean what? Get your feet off the ground. The same way you walk, that's all you got to do, just dance. Get your feet off the ground. But some, I can't do that. I can't do, this is bothering me, that is bothering me. And it's going to continue to bother you. Why? Because you're not in faith. You're not doing what God says do. Unless you do what God says do, it ain't going to work for you. It's not going to work for you. But when you start doing what God says do, all of a sudden you're healed in the name of Jesus. You're healed in the name of Jesus. I see you smiling, Joe. Listen to this. Romans chapter 5, I close here with verse 1 on down to verse 5. Therefore, being justified by faith and patience, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace. Grace is God's unmerited favor. Grace is how we get saved. For by grace are we saved. How? Through faith. And that not of yourself. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Faith is a gift of God. Grace is a gift of God. He says, by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Hope to the end. Remember we read that? Hope to the end. So we rejoice in hope until we get to the end. We rejoice in hope. Now notice this now. He says in verse 3, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations. Oh, I love this. I love this. We glory in tribulations. Tribulations is three times the trouble. Seeing that the devil can get you, per se, in three times the trouble, and you can't glorify God, then you are already stuck in the rut. You're stuck in the rut. But he tells us, right, he's telling us in Romans chapter 5, he says in verse 3, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations. We glory in temptation, tests, and trials. Think about that. Do you glory in temptation? Do you glory in tests? Do you glory in trials? Temptation, tests, and trials. Do you glory in pain? Or do you just simply say, you know, I'm not doing so good? What did God say? I'm doing better. I'm doing better. And when you confess that, you possess that. Before you know it, you're doing better. But if you confess, I'm not doing so good, do you think that's going to get better? It's going to get worse. I'm not doing so good. I'm not doing so good. And you're not going to do good. Why? Because you're not confessing it. And if you can't say it, you can't have it. He says here, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. What are you going through in your marriage? Glorify God. Don't go home and shut the door and looking all sad and you just came from church. Whether it's a husband or a wife, just come from church and looking all sad. Why should I go to church? And I'm already sad and you come back from church and you're looking sad. What sense does that make for me to go to church? But when you come back glorifying God, hallelujah, God is so good. Oh, the Lord is good to me. My, when you come in the house like that, whether it's a husband or wife, they say, oh, what kind of church service was that? Oh, it's glorious. It's magnificent. The Lord is on my side. The Lord is blessing me. The Lord is helping me. The Lord, I'm glorifying the Lord. Woo, Lord. Woo, Lord. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. Knowing that tribulation work patience. And patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. What this is saying, the process is saying, the word comes. Then faith comes. See, when the word is preached, faith comes. Faith come by hearing, and hearing the word of God. The word comes. Faith comes. Then what comes? Here comes the devil. Here comes the devil. The word comes, faith comes, here comes the devil. To do what? To bring tribulation. Here comes the devil to test you, to try you. The word come, faith come, here comes the devil. What's next? Patience. Let patience go to work on the devil. I mean, patience will outlast the devil. No matter what the devil bring against you, patience will outlast the devil. It's the force of consistency causing you to remain constant and always the same. The word come, faith come, here comes the devil. Then what's next? Patience. And then what patience does? Brother, patience bring you into inexperience. Before you know it, you done gone through the valley. Before you know it, God done shown himself in a strong and magnificent way. Before you know it, all of a sudden you're able to say, this is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. I couldn't do this. I don't know how I could have got out of this. But the Lord made a way where there was no way. The Lord has made a way where there was no way. The word comes. Faith comes. Here comes the devil. Let patience go to work, and patience will bring you into your experience. And see, unless you have an experience with God, unless you have an experience with God getting you through whatever you're going through, unless you have an experience with God, then you will never come into the hope. Because the word comes, faith comes, here comes the devil. Let patience go to work. Patience bring you into an experience, Teresa. And then from the experience, you end up with hope, which is a confident, favorable expectation. Meaning you, listen, you will never, never, ever, when you get the experience, when you really get that experience, you will never, ever turn your back on God. Because you know that God is getting me through what I'm going through. God has a way where no one else have a way. God has a way of getting me through this thing. God's going to get me through this thing. God's going to help me through this thing. If you let patience go to work, it's faith and patience that inherits the promise. Give Jesus a praise. Give him a praise.
It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord, and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High. To show forth thy loving kindness in the morning, and thy faithfulness every night. Upon an instrument of 10 strings, and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hands. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep. A brutish man knoweth not, neither doth a fool understand this. When the wicked spring as the grass, and when all the workers of iniquity do flourish, it is that they shall be destroyed forever. But thou, Lord, art most high for evermore. For lo, thine enemies, O Lord, for lo, thine enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But my horn shall thou exalt like the horn of a unicorn. I shall be anointed with fresh oil. Mine eye also shall see my desire on mine enemies, and mine ears shall hear my desire of the wicked that rise up against me. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. To show that the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him.